But we have a question in chat concerning the contents of the lecture. I did not understand concerning the context of the previous of the or the next one.
No, I guess it was about music, probably. So it was about music, and my pleasure actually say that the music we were listening to was by Pavel Parmanov, who is a modern Russian composer. So you can find him on YouTube. You can find him anywhere. So I will on Spotify. I really enjoy listening to him. I will write his name in the chat. Okay. Well, anyway, thank you very much for coming again. Yes, Yuliya, please.
Thank you. I shall share the screen. No, this one, this will be the next one. Another one. This lecture. So good morning to everybody. I'm happy to see you again. Now we have the last day of the lectures, and as I promised, we shall start with another financial applications of fractional Brownian motion, namely when we insert memory into stochastic volatility. But at the beginning, let us say some words concerning the asset price with stochastic volatility, option prices, discretization, and so on. So this is the outline of our lecture, and let us start. So beginning with the pioneer works by Hull and White and Heston, models of financial market whose asset prices include stochastic volatility have been the subject of an intensive research activity. The question is how to model stochastic volatility in general without any restrictions. Concerning this question, how to model stochastic volatility, we can give some example. For example, some approaches in terms of Gaussian processes were considered. Here are the papers of Nicolata Venardas, Schobel and Zhu. Non-Gaussian processes, the papers of Barndorf, Nielsen and Shepard, special models, however, very interesting ones. But all these models are continuous. Jump diffusion, Levy processes, for example, considered by Ramakant and Tankov, Kipriano and Schutens. Time series, here are some examples, Carrasco and Chen, Palm, Shepard, so on. Only some examples how we can model the stochastic volatility. For the models of financial market, where the asset price includes stochastic volatility and includes the stochastic volatility with long memory in the volatility process, we can mention the papers Bollerslev and Mikkelsen, where a wide class of fractionally integrated Garch and Degarch models to characterize financial market volatility was studied. Content et al. For AFIN, very interesting paper for AFIN fractional stochastic volatility models. Chronopoulos and Wietz, also interesting paper where the Heston model with fractional and Stein-Uhlenbeck stochastic volatility was studied. Long memory included into volatility model allows to explain some option pricing puzzles, such as sleep volatility, smiles in long-term options, and co-movements between implied and realized volatility. Therefore, the inserting memory was natural, not simply, let us consider something. Short memory leads to RAF volatility. As a rule, the option pricing in stochastic volatility models needs some approximation procedures, including Monte Carlo methods. What about our approach? We consider fractional Einstein Uhlenbeck process with Hughes index from 0 to 1, and several approaches to the exact and approximate option pricing of the asset price model that is described by geometric linear model with stochastic volatility, where volatility is driven by fractional Einstein Uhlenbeck process. We assume that the Wiener process driving the asset price and the fractional Brownian motion driving stochastic volatility can be correlated. We consider three possible levels of representation and approximation of option price. These levels appear naturally when we considered our model. And we study this together with the corresponding grade of convergence of discretized option price to the original one. As I said before, of course, financial markets act in discrete time, but analytical approach is much more convenient for continuous time. Therefore, we should to establish the convergence of discrete time prices to continuous time prices and the rate of convergence, which is very important. So we shall consider analytical approach to continuous time and then discretize. This is our approach. In advance to consider continuous time model and then try to discretize. Okay. What about payoff functions? We consider a specific class of payoff functions. They can be discontinuous and they can be of polynomial growth. Polynomial growth is not so crucial. However, possibility of discontinuity of payoff function is very crucial. I shall explain why. Why it is not necessary to consider discontinuous payoff functions. Because, for example, our model can allow to analyze linear combinations of digital and call options. Digital option is discontinuous, some indicator, and the call option is of polynomial growth, so they are inserted into the class of the models under consideration. Moreover, we provide rigorous estimates for the rate of convergence of option prices for such polynomial discontinuous payoffs, let them be F. Also, we assume that coefficients are Hölder, coefficients for volatility are Hölder continuity. And this is also a crucial feature considering settings for which exact price is not possible. Exact pricing is possible for very, very narrow class of option prices. Therefore, the question of discretization is very important and very often. Maybe except Black-Scholes formula, we cannot do anything. So what we consider? We consider a financial market characterized by a finite maturity time T capital, it will be fixed, and composed by a risky-free bond or bank account of the standard form. Its dynamic reads as follows. A bond is exponent of rho T, now it is rho. Rho is some non-negative number, and this formula represents the risk-free interest rate. Risky asset has stochastic price dynamic, which is defined over some probability space, of course, with filtration, and is defined by the following system of stochastic differential equations. So let us consider the equations. We have, if to cancel this sigma that depends on another process, we shall have simply Black-Scholes model. So for the outer risky asset, we assume that except this stochastic volatility, we have a very standard situation. But stochastic volatility is modeled by fractional Lundstein-Lindberg process, the process that we have considered in detail before. And what about the function sigma? We shall formulate the conditions a little bit later. So this is stochastic volatility. What about the processes? So we have Wiener process here, absolutely standard Wiener process. Some coefficients, alpha is assumed to be non-negative, so we have ergodic case because this coefficient is negative. And our Lundstein-Lindberg process, as you see, is the argument of function sigma. What are other our assumptions? So in general, all the talk will be based on our paper with Victor Bezbarodov and Lukadi Persio. And in the paper itself, we consider the whole range of Hurst indexes from 0 to 1. And also we assumed that fractional Brownian motion and Wiener process are correlated. In the paper, we consider the most general case, possible correlation, H from 0 to 1, it is possible. However, in the talk, because I prefer to present not so technical results, but to demonstrate the principal ideas, we shall restrict ourselves to the case where W and BH are independent, because this correlation leads to some additional technical terms, but not to some new principal ideas. Let them be for the moment non-correlated. Hurst parameter from 0 to 1/2 can be considered, and we have done it. But also, you remember maybe that in the case when H is from 0 to 1/2, fractional Lundstein-Lindberg process should be considered via integration by parts, and it will consist of one additional term. As well, some additional technical details, but let us consider the principal idea. So for the moment and in the talk, we shall consider only H from 1/2. However, I emphasize again that all H are possible, rough volatility, smooth volatility, only some additional technical details. So I recall, but everybody knows what is fractional Brownian motion. We consider its modification that is Hölder up to order H. We assume so that H is more than 1/2. So our fractional Brownian motion has a log memory. It is suitable for stochastic volatility which accumulates the memory of the model. Contrary to this, some modern markets demonstrate rough volatility, but I shall explain again that in our model, rough volatility can be considered and some principal difference, only some technical difficulties. What about arbitrage property and the completeness of the market? It can be arbitrage free because here we have stochastic integral with respect to Wiener process, and under the assumption that its mathematical expectation exists, it is a martingale. So we have under suitable conditions on sigma, we can have arbitrage free market. But in any case, it is incomplete because we have here two sorts of uncertainty. Independently, if BH and W are dependent or independent, in any case, even if they are correlated but not so strongly, we have two sources of uncertainty. It means immediately that the market is incomplete because only one asset price and two sorts of uncertainty. Since it is incomplete, it is not very interesting to consider the case of martingale measure, because you know that for incomplete markets, the number of martingale measure is infinite. In this connection, we restrict ourselves to the physical measure, to the objective measure. What can we say in this case? Among all martingale measures on incomplete market, we can define one specific measure, minimal martingale measure. However, when we analyze the option price with respect to minimal martingale measure and with respect to physical measure, in our model, they were different only by some multiplicative constant. So when we analyze the market with respect to physical measure, it is suitable for our goals. Now, what about the payoff function? So we consider a measurable function defined by some simple f, let it be for the moment and for the all this part. It acts from r plus to r plus, so of course it is non-negative. And it is something that depends only on the value st of the stock at maturity. However, it does not save us from the past, because the value of st at maturity depends, you will see, it depends, it is, of course, some exponent of the integral, and integral depends on the whole past of y. So even we have this simple situation, it is not Markov because of the dependence of the stochastic integral of the whole past. Now, what is our goal? To calculate and to approximate the option price with respect to physical measure and with respect to different levels. What about levels? It will be clear later. Also, we provide rigorous estimates for the corresponding rate of convergence for the first and second levels, and I shall specify what is second level, what is first level, what is third level. So this is our goal. What about our goal and why we have some difficulties? Because of possible discontinuity of function f. If we cannot calculate this price explicitly, we shall approximate it. But since f has discontinuities, we can have a great error. Because when we approximate option price, it can be on one side, on another side, and f has discontinuity, so on one side of the point of discontinuity and on another side of point of discontinuity, and we get essential error. So to approximate this price directly is impossible. It will lead to great error and will be not suitable for any goal. So let us be more involved, and let us go in some indirect way. How to do it? Let us consider our model of upset price, payoff function, some additional assumptions, and some auxiliary properties. So what we assume more precisely concerning payoff function and concerning function sigma? So payoff function f satisfies the following condition. It is a measurable function of polynomial growth, of any polynomial growth. It is a matter of practitioners to say which polynomial growth is more suitable for asset prices. However, for us in our theory, it does not matter. Let it be any p. This p does not influence much the rate of convergence, the convergent result, so on. Also, we assume that function f is locally Riemann integrable and possibly has discontinuous of the first kind. such as, for example, digital option. But of course, it can be much more complicated. There are all assumptions of F, nothing else. Concerning sigma, we assume the following. Of course, it is also a measurable function, but it satisfies the following condition. The first condition is that sigma is separated from zero. As usual, volatility is preferable to consider positive. But now the volatility is stochastic and depends on time and depends on the process. Therefore, we assume something more. We assume that it is separated from zero by some constant. It is very, very important supposition. We cannot avoid it. Another supposition is that sigma has moderate polynomial growth. Not such as was for function f. For function f, it does not matter. But only q will be the power of growth, and it will be from 0 to 1. Why? Because sigma is substituted into stochastic integral, and we want to integrate and we want to integrate this stochastic differential equation, get the solution. And for this solution, we want to consider the price. The price is something like this. So sigma will be involved in the stochastic integral, and for all objects to be correctly defined, sigma will not grow very rapidly, only with such rate, not more. This rate from 0 to 1. Yes. Also, we assume that sigma is uniformly Hölder continuous, as I said before, so that there exists some R can be to 1 including, so that the increment of sigma does not exceed x minus y to power r. The condition of differentiability almost everywhere with respect to Lebesgue measure, and to have the derivative of polynomial growth, but for the derivative, the order of the growth does not matter, so it can be any q prime. At this place, sometimes people have a question, what about interception of this condition? Conditions. The situation is none of them includes another one. So we can provide an examples of the functions that satisfy all three conditions from these four, all set of three conditions, and not satisfying the fourth one. So these conditions are not completely overlapping. We have some examples, but I omit the examples now. It is not so important. Now, what about fractional Brownian motion? Recall that it admits a compact interval representation via some another Wiener process. Of course, not those W that is inserted into the asset price. More specifically, we have this compact integral representation, and in order to simplify the representation, we consider h which is more than 1/2, because we know that in this case, Volterra kernel is simplified to one term. And the term is of the following form with such constant, but the value of constant now is not very important. So this Wiener process is called underlying Wiener process for fractional Brownian motion, and W is an underlying Wiener process for asset price. And if we assume that fractional Brownian motion and Wiener process W are correlated, then this process B and W are correlated as well. And in general, when we consider situation of correlation, we assume that they are correlated in the standard way. But for the technical simplicity of the presentation, we assume independence. So for the moment, rho is zero. Now, what are about some auxiliary results? So the first result is, our equation, our Langevin equation, which determines Ornstein-Ollenberg process, has a unique solution of the following form. You know this form. What is important for us? For us, it is important that the solution is a Gaussian process, and therefore, for any beta which is less strictly than 2, we have exponential moments with any coefficient. Why supremum? Because of results of Fernick, deep results concerning Gaussian process for Gaussian process itself without supremum, it is evident, it is a result of Dirac calculation, but with supremum we can rely on some results of the classics of theory of Gaussian process, Fernick, for example, and state the following. What about our main equation? I recall it form. This is our main equation for asset price. All coefficients except sigma are linear, both drift and diffusion coefficient, and therefore this equation has a unique solution of the following form. Here is drift, here is our stochastic term, and you see that we integrate sigma. And we can guess that the condition of sigma B of sublinear growth is assumed because we want to supply the existence of this integral. And this term evidently appears due to Itô formula for martingale processes. What we have concerning the moments? If our function f is of polynomial growth, then we can state that at first all the moments of this S exist because of this property of sigma, that sigma is of sublinear growth. And moreover, f is of polynomial growth, therefore all the moments of f of st also are finite. So this concerns the properties of existence, uniqueness of the solution, and the moments of the solution, and of our option price, and even any moment of f of st. So we have a correctly defined situation. We have asset price that includes stochastic volatility. Stochastic volatility is modeled for such processes. For the moment, we assume that BH and W are independent. However, correlated process, correlated situation also can be considered, and let us proceed with option pricing. But now I return to the problem that was described a little bit earlier. So we want to approximate, because we cannot calculate it explicitly, to approximate this option price. But we know that F has discontinuities, and we can get a big error if the approximate price will be on the one hand of some point of discontinuity, and the real price will be on the another side of discontinuity, and the error will be unavoidable. If we approximate this formula as it is, error will be unavoidable. So we go in such indirect way. We decide, since we have here function f, let us provide something as integration by parts. Not to consider f itself, but we assumed, if you remember, that f is locally Riemann integrable, And if it has discontinuous only of the first kind, then the Riemann integral will be continuous. So our goal is to transform our option price from this form to the form in which will be inserted some primitive of function f. Primitive will be some continuous function. But we cannot do it simply by integration by parts because of existence of ST. ST is a stochastic process. It is impossible to integrate by parts under the sign of mathematical expectation and so on. What to do in this case? In this case, we have such power tool as Malyavin calculus. Instead of integrating by parts as we do simply for non-random functions, we shall apply Malyavin calculus, insert some stochastic derivatives and some integral instead of derivative, and transform our formula into formula that will contain primitive function. How to realize this plan? It is possible. So let us consider some elements of Malyavin calculus and application to our option pricing situation. To apply Malyavin calculus to the asset price S, note that we have two-dimensional case with two independent Wiener processes. We consider different possibilities how to apply Malyavin derivative. And finally, we decided that it is more convenient to ignore fractional Brownian motion itself, because it, in general, it is possible to consider Malyavin calculus directly for fractional Brownian motion. But for our purposes, it is more convenient to ignore fractional Brownian motion, not ignore, of course, but to ignore it in the sense of taking Malyavin derivatives, and to consider two underlying processes and take Malyavin derivatives with respect to fractional Brownian motion as we take them with respect to B, but taking them into account, of course, the kernel. It will be more convenient. With evident modifications denote by dwdb, the stochastic derivative with respect to the two-dimensional Wiener process. So if w and b are independent, then we have the case of two-dimensional Wiener process. And let us take Malyavin derivatives with respect to these processes. Note that the process x, that is a logarithm of s, has the following representation. Of course, you understand that logarithm s0 is not important. We can assume that s0 equals 1 and cancel this logarithm. So only these terms are interesting. And only with respect to these terms, we shall take Malyavin derivative or stochastic derivative. What about stochastic derivative with respect to, for example, for Wiener process? Let us consider for the moment this integral orally, and then look at the formulas. So let we have this integral and want to take stochastic derivative. Stochastic derivative of the stochastic integral equals to this integrand when we have stochastic, when we take stochastic derivative at the point u that does not exceed t. If the point exceeds t, then stochastic derivative equals zero. We have this situation that stochastic derivative, for example, of this integral with respect to w will equal sigma of ys if s is between 0 and t. It does not matter that we have here a stochastic process. Only important thing that is that we have independent process. In the case of correlation, the formula will be more complicated. So we remember that the derivative of the integral is integrand, roughly speaking. So What about stochastic derivative for fractional Brownian motion? With respect to Wiener process, in fractional Brownian motion is independent, it is simply zero. With respect to underlying Wiener process, kernel, the same as here. For fractional Brownian motion, we have integral representation with B and some kernel, and we get integrand. What is now integrand? It is kernel. But here is an indicator that U does not exceed T. What about stochastic derivatives of Y? It is better to integrate by parts and get the representation of Y in which fractional Brownian motion is simply under the sign of integral. And then we can differentiate stochastically. This is a stochastic derivative of a fractional Brownian motion itself. And this is stochastic derivative of additional term. Here we had fractional Brownian motion. We differentiate stochastic derivative of all constants and non-random functions we can put out of the sign of stochastic derivative. So this is the formula. What about stochastic derivative of x? I recall that x is a logarithm. It was explained more or less. However, I shall explain again. So with respect to w, with respect to w, no w here, this term is independent on w, so zero. Here we have integrand. This is integrand. And with respect to fractional Brownian motion, we don't take the derivative of W. We only take the derivatives of these functions which depend on B. But the stochastic derivative of some function admits a chain rule. So for example, when we differentiate sigma square, we get sigma, sigma prime, and you understand that the existence of derivative of sigma was necessary. And here is the derivative of y, but the derivative of y was calculated. The same situation is here. We differentiate sigma, we ignore w, it is here as it was before. It was not differentiated, and we differentiate sigma, chain rule, and then we differentiate this inner function. But for this derivative as well, we know its formula. So these are some formulas for stochastic derivatives. Now, let us introduce the following notation. Let we have our initial function f, but I recall that we consider f, where it is here. We consider f of st. So this is our desirable option price. But st in turn has this exponent representation. According to this representation, and putting s0 equal 1, not to be inserted in calculations, let it be 1, we consider f of exponent. This is our j. Why we insert this function? Because on one hand, it is interesting to consider the option price in terms of f, but on the other hand, it can be represented, of course, in terms of g. You understand that this is very clear connection of them. And let it be our primitive function, as I explained before, so we can integrate. And let it be g capital will be integral of g small. So we have four functions. Our f is primitive function, f of exponent, some logarithmic function, it will be g, and also it's primitive function as well. Stochastic integration, we also need in the following integral. This integral is well defined because previously we assumed that sigma is separated from zero. So sigma minus one is bounded by some constant. And therefore, no problem with existence of the moment properties of this integral. It is well defined. And now we are in position to transform the option prices in such a way that it doesn't contain discontinuous functions. We apply the tool of Malyavin calculus, and when we consider the price, I recall again, but maybe everybody remembers, so we consider this price. In some sense, what we do, I shall omit the technical details. However, principally what we do, we go from F to F capital. However, for S, we take stochastic derivative. This is the sense of integration by parts in stochastic sense, in Malyavin sense. And after this, we get immediately the following result. In general, this result, not for fractional Brownian motion, but for two-winner process, was considered in the paper Altmaier and Neuenkirch. It is in references, which was in some sense starting point for our considerations. When we consider the paper, we decided to insert instead of Brownian motion, fractional Brownian motion. Of course, on this way, we got some principal difficulties and principal difference. However, the original idea to apply Malyavin calculus is the same. So let us return to our main result. What is the main result? Under the conditions A on function F, polynomial growth, possibility of discontinuity, but locally Riemann integrability, and B on sigma, Hölder property existing on derivative, sublinear growth, and something else, but it was commented before. The option price, our initial option price, that also can be rewritten in the following way. I recall that we substitute here X and get the same option price. It can be represented as follows. So here we have F small, but we get applying Malyavin calculus, we get F capital. F capital will be of the same point. However, due to taking stochastic derivative, we get additional multiplier. Alternatively, this price can be written in the following way. T in the denominator appears because of stochastic differentiation and this value, but we can reduce to G. And now up to you, what formula is more convenient, we shall say. Okay, so what we achieved? The situation when we under the sign of mathematical expectation, we do not have any discontinuity. We have continuous functions with some additional multipliers. Of course, this additional multiplier adds some difficulty, but what can we do? Our goal was to avoid discontinuity, and all multipliers are, this is a fixed random variable, no problem with continuity or discontinuity, and this function is now continuous. So the problem of approximation now can be started. And what about the convergence of approximate option prices and the rate of convergence? So what we have, let us analyze what we have under the sign of the mathematical expectation. We have ST that depends both on Wiener process and fractional Brownian motion. We have the T that is also function of fractional Brownian motion and more exactly the function of fractional Einstein-Uhlenbeck process. And what is the difficulty? It depends on the whole trajectory. We cannot say something concerning distribution of the whole integral because it involve the whole trajectory of y. This is a difficulty for discretization. However, the most simple idea, the first idea for the discretization is to consider discretization both of a Wiener process. So for example, for this integral and for fractional Brownian motion as well. So the first idea is to discretize both processes, because both processes are involved into the formula for option price. Now, this is the first approach. This is the first level of approach. So let us consider the first approach to numerical approximation of the option pricing problem. Consider equidistant partition of our interval 0 t capital. Here are the points of partition. And define the discretization of both of Wiener process and fractional Brownian motion. So we consider the values of Wiener process and fractional Brownian motion at these points. Consider the increments, and instead of any stochastic integral, we shall consider corresponding integral sums. How this discretization works? Discretized processes y and x corresponding to a given partition have the following form. This is a very simple form for the discretization of y. We simply consider, I don't know if they can be named as Euler approximation, however, maybe, because it is very simple approximation. Very simple approximation. Yes, we can name it Euler, but for such a very simple form, it does not matter. Now, what about x? So we discretize initial value, let it be here, however, we can put it zero, because it is logarithm of a zero. Here we discretize, we consider this point tg, so we discretize the drift. We discretize Riemann integral, and here we have discretized version of y. And this is discretized version of stochastic integral. Of course, we can write it again in the form of integrals, because we can consider any integral sum as the integral, but of the stepwise function. Considering the term Zt, we also can discretize it in the same manner. And we define S as the exponent of discretized X. What can we state? Let me have conditions A and B. Then there exists a constant C, not depending on N. It can depend on T, on H, and on anything else fixed. However, not depending on N. Such that for our initial price that we don't know, and the discretized price, which we consider according to the formula that we obtained. So in this case, the rate of convergence is n to power rh. What is r? R was in the condition of on our functions. Let it let us recall. So R is the Hölder index. R is from 0 to 1. Of course, it can be 1. However, it can be assumed that it is smaller. So we have the rate of convergence that is connected to R here and to H, and on nothing else. Anything else is included into constant. So this is our rate of convergence. H is more than 1/2, but R can be small. So the rate of convergence, of course, is not very high. However, it is impossible to get something else because of the properties of discretization of the integral with respect to fractional Brownian motion. You know that when we consider the discretization of fractional integral, some fractional derivatives appear and they don't permit to get the good rate of convergence. This is the principal thing. So we have the following rate of convergence. But then our idea was to simplify the situation. We looked at the formula of option price and we decided to consider what will be if we fix the trajectory of y. The difficulty when we calculate this option price is that it depends on the whole trajectory of y. But let us for the moment fix this trajectory. What will be? Will we get some simplification? Yes, indeed. And I shall explain. So this section is devoted to the implementation of the second approach or second level to approximate the option price. It is based on the fact that in the case when W and B are independent, logarithm of asset price is conditionally Gaussian under the fixed trajectory of fractional Brownian motion. Let us look at the situation. Indeed, if to analyze the formula for X, here it is, we see that additional source of uncertainty comes from y. And if we, for the moment, decide that the trajectory of y is fixed, so no additional source of uncertainty, the trajectory is fixed, then we have only one source of uncertainty here. We have so-called Wiener integral with respect to Wiener process of, for the moment, non-random process. And so we have here, if the trajectory of y is fixed, here we have simply something non-random, and here we have sigma also non-random, and of course such integral is Gaussian because the integral of non-random function with respect to Gaussian process, if it exists, is Gaussian. This is the idea of the second level of discretization. So let us return to the explanations. This situation means that logarithm, our x logarithm of asset price is conditionally Gaussian under the fixed trajectory of fractional Brownian motion. And if trajectory of fractional Brownian motion is fixed, then trajectory of y is also fixed. Idea allows to exclude Wiener process from the consideration because when we fix trajectory of y, we calculate something with respect to w, but with respect to w, all the all the calculations are very simple. And we can exclude the Wiener process from the consideration absolutely. And then we return to our option price, insert, of course, instead of fixed trajectory, insert the stochastic trajectory, and calculate the option price explicitly in terms of the trajectory of fractional Brownian motion. So we freeze it for the moment, and then we decide to unfreeze it again. Respectively, we can discretize and simulate only the trajectories of fractional Brownian motion. If previously we had double discretization, now we shall have single discretization. We can get the explicit option pricing formula and the functional of the trajectory of fractional Brownian motion and obtain the rate of convergence. What is interesting, comparing the previous theorem, here is previous theorem, and here is the rate of convergence. Since the rate of convergence is based only on properties of sigma and the Hurst index, when we have a single discretization, the rate of convergence is the same. However, we have the same bound, the same rate of convergence. However, this is an interesting story with simulations, but maybe I shall stop here and explain this specifics in the second part of the lecture. So thank you very much for attention for this moment. Let us have some 5 minutes break.
Yes, thank you, Yuliya. Just at the moment, do you have any questions? Does anybody have a question right now? If not, then we stop for 5 minutes and return at exactly 11 o'clock. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, we start again. So please, Yuliya.
Thank you, Elena. I shall continue. So in order to implement our second level of discretization, which I should say immediately that it will lead to much better simulations and much better calculations. What about simulations? When we simulate the trajectories of stochastic processes, it is not so easy to supply independence. Therefore, when we discretize both the processes in some empirical simulations, then we get not so good result. However, this second level permits us to avoid many difficulties, to avoid simulation of two independent processes. We consider only one process and it leads to much better coincidence with of prices, with the real price. But in order to implement this approach, let us introduce the following notations. Let the covariance matrix read as follows. And what are the elements of this matrix? This is sigma y prime. It is the integral of sigma square. It is a squared characteristics of stochastic integral with respect to w of sigma. Let also denote my. And let sigma z will be corresponding integral, but sigma minus one. So we have integral with respect to inner process, and then its square characteristics is sigma minus two of y ds, Lebesgue Stieltjes integral. And let delta be the, how it is named in English, determinant. Yes. Let it be determinant of our covariance matrix. Why it is covariance matrix? you see, this is a covariance of integral with respect to Wiener process, but of sigma. This is the covariance of the corresponding process, but of sigma minus one. But if we have covariance of these two integrals, we should multiply sigma by sigma minus one and get one. Therefore, here we have simply t. M is auxiliary notation. So let it be determinant of our covariance matrix. Of course, it equals sigma y square sigma z square minus t square. And of course, it is greater or equal zero. It is non-negative. We assume additionally that the following exception is fulfilled. Our determinant is positive with probability one. Our guess in general is this is the case if sigma is, and I'm sure that it is, but we did not calculate it. I am sure that if sigma is non-constant, then it is positive with probability one because its distribution has full support. However, for the moment, we did not check it. It is a small problem. We did not solve it. We simply assume. But I'm sure that it is an unnecessary assumption, except the case when sigma is constant. I think I can prove it. I think I can prove it. Okay. Note that the random vector, now let us consider this random vector. Here we have our x logarithm of asset price, and here we have our z. This is our notation for z. Is Gaussian conditionally to the given trajectory of y? So if y is fixed, we have here a non-random function, non-random function, non-random function. So only Gaussian process w is inserted. And this vector is Gaussian. And conditional covariance matrix is our CZ. Next lemma present common conditional density of xt and zt. Under this assumption C, the distribution of xt zt is non-degenerate. And we can divide by the value of delta. Delta is a determinant of this covariance matrix. Now, let we have this assumption C, which seems to be almost everywhere hold. Then the common conditional density of this vector conditionally to the given trajectory of I equals the following form. We calculated it explicitly. It is simply the conditional density of the matrix with of the vector with known covariance matrix. And we simply apply this formula. And you see that here we divide by delta, so delta should be positive almost surely. So this is a conditional density. And in this density, you see my is inserted, this auxiliary notation, because it is in some sense conditional mean. And sigma y is inserted. This is sigma z, of course, they are some conditional variances. But you understand that this conditional density is random, is stochastic. The next result states that option price can be represented as a functional only of sigma y. Let me recall again what is sigma y. Sigma y is the integral of sigma square to which y is inserted. So in general, this functional depends on the whole trajectory of y. However, only of y, not of underlying linear process w. And we have this conditional density, and in terms of it, we can state that our option price can be presented as a functional only of sigma y, but sigma y is only the functional of the trajectory of Ornstein fractional Uhlenbeck process. So under conditions A from A to C, We have the following equality. Our option price equals what we have here. We have here integral over R of G capital. G capital, what is it? It was introduced when we consider the primitive functions. Here it is. It is a primitive function of G small, and G small is some transformation of initial payoff function F. So what we have again, what we have here, we have mathematical, we could insert the sign of mathematical expectation under the sign of integral, some kind of Fubini theorem. And now you see our common density, and we take mathematical expectation with respect to this density. So we have the term of the following form, and we take components of the density and transform. You see that even with respect to density, into the density we have sigma z, we have my, we have sigma y. But in the formula, we have no sigma z. We have only sigma y and my. Only the characteristics of y in terms of sigma, not sigma minus one even. So we have the following formula for calculation of option pricing. It is not so convenient in what term, in what sense? G is convenient. But we should take mathematical expectation. We have here sigma y to power three, sigma y. So we shall calculate this. However, the calculation is more simple in comparison with the case when we have sigma y and w, both of them. Now, what is our main result? The rate of convergence. So in order to state the main result of the present section, let us define the following quantities. This is discretized sigma y. We need this discretization of it. This is discretized my. Also, we need to discretize. This is the exact option price. This is the approximation of option price, in which we insert instead of my and sigma y our approximations. And we state that the rate of convergence is the same. Even in this case, we cannot achieve the better rate of convergence because we have sigma, we have fractional Brownian motion, and these two factors determine the rate of convergence. So theoretically, the rate of convergence is the same, but practically, this formula is much more better. Okay, now what we have? We have a specific situation here. So we have under the sign of integral some mathematical expectation. But how to calculate this mathematical expectation, taking in mind that it depends on only one random variable? So it is possible to calculate this mathematical expectation if we know the density of this random variable. But the difficulty is that this random variable depends on the whole trajectory, and we don't know the distribution of the whole trajectory. So in order to reduce this formula to the formula in which only some non-random objects will be inserted and their density will be considered, we tried to simplify our mathematical expectation, maybe not to simplify, but to represent it as people represent mathematical expectations, as the integral of the function under consideration and its density. So the next goal, the third level, is to avoid this mathematical expectation under the sign of integral and to reduce the formula to the view that is more or less standard for us. Okay, how we do it? So we see that the option price depends on this random variable. So it is natural to derive the density of this random variable, but it depends on the whole trajectory. Therefore, when we have the situation with the whole trajectory, not with only one random variable, we apply Malavian calculus because for Malavian calculus, the whole trajectory is one element, one random element. So we apply Malavian calculus in attempt to find this density. What is the situation? We got this density. How to deal with it? It is another story. Now we are in the process of dealing with this density, with statistical dealing, because you will see that the density is not so simple and it is predictable. So we introduce additional assumptions on the function sigma. We assume additionally, previously we assumed that sigma is differentiable. Now we assume that it is twice differentiable. Its derivative is strictly non-negative. And both of them, sigma prime, sigma two prime, are of polynomial growth. Now we go to the results of David Nollard, who presented the density of such integrals. And we can state that under assumption B, B is the assumption on sigma, and the previous assumption and the present assumption on sigma, so B and D are assumption on sigma. The following stochastic process, here is a stochastic derivative, Malavian derivative of our functional sigma y square, I recall, here is it. Of course, we can calculate its stochastic derivative. It is its norm, Hilbert norm, Hilbert value norm. And it can be stated that this stochastic process belongs to the domain of the Skorochod integral. Why we need in Skorochod integral? Because our density will be represented in the terms of Skorochod integral. Now let us introduce some notations. It is not so easy to deal with the denominator in such cases. So let it be simply eta for the moment. Also, let me consider the this is the kernel for our, if you remember, this is the kernel for our fractional derivative of fractional Einstein-Nuremberg process. Kappa is the product of sigma and sigma prime. And we can represent the density. Of course, it is a question if the density exists. If the density of sigma y exists, it exists. And moreover, we can state that the density of this random variable is bounded, which is interesting, continuous, and is given by the following formula. Since this fraction belongs to the domain of Skorochod integral, then we can integrate. Here, additional indicator is inserted, and taking this mathematical expectation, we get the difference. Of course, it is very specific formula of Malavian calculus. However, we can represent it at least in such a form. But moreover, this Skorochod integral, we are lucky that it is in fact reduced to a Wiener integral. No Skorochod integral is needed. Therefore, I even did not explain what is Skorochod integral, because immediately it disappears and we get simply Wiener integral of the following form, where some Malavian derivatives are inserted. However, we can calculate them. And you see that we have here integration with respect to the underlying process for our fractional Brownian motion. And here we have kappa. Kappa, of course, is random, but it does not matter. Here we integrate only some non-random function. L is kernel, U is a non-random function. No problem with this. So this very complicated objects for a hot integral is simply reduced to such a comparatively simple object. And taking into account this representation, we can say that the option price can be represented as the integral with respect to our density. And finally, we get a formula that is more convenient to look at, because in this formula we have only some non-random function, as we see in any mathematical expectation, and here we have the density and nothing else. Of course, you can immediately say how to calculate this density, and I answer, yes, we are approaching how to calculate it. Now constructed some codes, and I hope that we succeed with this, but it is in progress. So what about simulations? How to illustrate these theoretical results? Since we have two discretization schemes, I will not take into consideration the third level. It is in progress. But we have two discretization schemes to simulate the option price. We treated double and single discretization. Double means that we discretize both the processes that are involved. Single means that we discretize only fractional Brownian motion, because Wiener process disappeared. The values of the coefficients are the same. Of course, they are not very important, and let them be some reasonable values. T equals one. B and alpha are of this value. So let us consider some values of H and consider different N and sigma. And let us compare the tables. The first table, double discretization. We consider, of course, comparatively simple option with payoff function for call option and for digital option. Let H is 0.6. And what is interesting, of course, in theory, we assume that sigma is separated from zero. Therefore, we take here some additional not big values and assume that it is separated from zero by these values. What we have concerning option prices? You see that the difference is comparatively big. For example, this is a number of n, and we have the difference in the second number after comma. The same situation will be with another H. You see also the difference in this number. And what about how to estimate the quality of simulations? Of course, to count mean squared errors. Mean squared errors for double discretization is big. It in turn, it means that double discretization is not optimal. Again, double discretization. Now, let us pass to single discretization. Now we see that the difference in the second number disappears. We have very similar results for any sigma. And you understand that now the results are much better. They are very comparable. The same situation here. you see that the first two numbers are the same. And again, mean squared errors. You see that now they are appropriate. Not so big as before, not exceed one. And in some cases, for example, for this function, are very small. Of course, when we approach zero, they increase. This is the same situation, but with another payoff function. So we see that the results of simulations related to a single discretization appear to be much more consistent and have much lower mean squared error. It is, of course, intuitively clear. However, our simulations are convincing with the intuition. It is interesting that we could provide numerical simulations even for sigma that is not separated from zero. In the theory, it need to be separated from zero, but in simulation, it is not necessary. We consider the case of absolute value modulo, which is not covered by our assumptions because it is not separated from zero. Double discretization does not work because Z contains the integral sigma minus one, and it is sensitive to the small values of sigma. Single discretization works because it does not involve this Z. And in this case, as before, since we can simulate something, having no theory, we get the following results. Even we compare our level two with direct average. And we can see that for level two, square mean error is much less. So we demonstrate several things. First, single discretization, of course, is better. Second, level two is better than even direct average. So our approach gives some advantages in any case. And the third thing that our theory is good, however, simulations work even in the case when our theory is not applicable. Now, some references. This is a starting point of Altmaier and Andreas Neuenkirch. They consider multi-level Monte Carlo quadrature of discontinuous payoffs. So we were inspired to also to consider discontinuous payoffs because it is really necessary. They had generalized Heston model, however, without fractional Brownian motion. Here are some references concerning the possible models of stochastic volatility. This is our paper for calculation and approximation of option pricing. Also some models of stochastic volatility. The paper of Boti was our origin for generator of fractional Brownian motion. Of course, there are a lot of generators. It is a separate story how to generate the trajectories of fractional Brownian motion. There are different approaches which are based on different representations of fractional Brownian motion. We studied only compact interval representation. However, fractional Brownian motion admits harmonizable representation. Representation as a series, you understand, as any Gaussian stochastic process, we can have some suitable basis of functions and can expand fractional Brownian motion, and people do so and consider a lot of generators. We take this one, but it is possible to take another one. Different models. I here are classical papers, pioneer papers of Heston and Holland White. Here is a good book of derivatives in financial markets with stochastic volatility. However, of course, it covers some more simple cases in comparison with ours. Some models and simulations, some other supplemented papers you see. And maybe that's all with this topic. However, my idea was to consider not only financial applications, but some statistical applications. Of course, now I have no enough of time to consider all of them. And so I decided to consider, so in this lecture, we have two statistical applications. In general, there is a lot of them. However, I decided to consider briefly the second one because this second one is for multi-fractional Brownian motion. And for me, it seemed that the participants were interested in this topic. So let us consider very briefly in the time that we have now, a half of an hour, drift parameter estimation in the models with multi-fractional Brownian motion. So very briefly. I shall not justify why we need in this. Maybe you are sure in this. And let us consider the model itself. So how to introduce multifractional Brownian motion? There are several approaches. Our approach is harmonizable representation. So let us consider some function which acts from r plus to 0, 1, continuous function, and satisfying the following conditions. There exist two constants, h1 and h2. h1 is separated from 0, it is important. h2 can approach 1, no problem with this. And we assume that our Hurst index function is between h1 and h2. Also, we assume that this function is Hilder continuous. So that there exist constants d and kappa, such that for any moments of time, of course, it is comparatively restricted assumption because we assume that the constant d does not depend on time. This function ht is assumed to be Hilder uniformly in time. So multifractional Brownian motion with functional parameter ht, it was introduced, our approach that we consider was introduced in the paper of Benassi. This process is defined as follows. So we note it as y. And it is harmonizable representation of fractional Brownian motion, exactly, but if we replace constant h by our function ht, which is between zero, separated from zero and one, of course, and is Hilder. Here, this Wiener measure is in some sense the Fourier transform of the white noise. Let me go to full screen. Yes, Fourier transform of the white noise W, that is a unique complex values random measure of the following form. Here is Fourier transform, here is Fourier transform. It was introduced in the papers again by Benassi, also in the paper of Stoyev and Taku. Covariance function of multifractional Brownian motion can be calculated, and it equals to the following value. This value is more or less similar to the corresponding value for fractional Brownian motion. However, here we have additional multiplier, and this multiplier also depends on HS and HU in the following way. If H is constant, then this is a standard multiplier for harmonizable representation of fractional Brownian motion. And this multiplier was calculated by Ayach. Also, it contains in the paper of Stoyev and Taku. If we have covariance function, we can calculate variance. Also, it has some non-constant multiplier now. But this function CH is bounded. Because we do not approach zero. We have sinus, we have here gamma, but H does not approach zero, so we are on the safe side. And under the assumptions M1 and M2, our basic assumptions, we can restrict the second moment of Y and prove that it achieves the bound H2. H2 is the upper bound for H capital. Of course, we shall interested in the asymptotic properties on infinity. Therefore, this bound will be considered only from one. You understand that it will be some game with indices, but for us it is not important for small t. Let t be from 1 to infinity. Now denote, so we have coefficient kappa, Hölder coefficient. Let H3 be minimal value of H1, which is left-hand bound and kappa. And this is the upper bound, maximum of H2 and kappa. And we introduce H5, which is a difference. Of course, H4 is bigger than H3. Under the assumption M1, there exists a constant such that for all t and s, we can bound the incremental variance of our multifractional Brownian motion in the following way. Additional function appears because we have non-constant H. If H is constant, then it disappears. And the upper bound is the same as for fractional Brownian motion. Of course, deal with these two terms is not so convenient. And omitting, maybe I shall not omit remark 9. Because it is interesting that there exist different definitions of multifractional Brownian motion. In particular, Peltier and Levy-Weil in this paper introduce multifractional Brownian motion based on Mandelbrot-Van-Ness representation. Simply inserting into Mandelbrot-Van-Ness representation HT instead of H. This version of multifractional Brownian motion is often termed as moving average multifractional Brownian motion. It has different covariance structure. Another version of Walter type multifractional Brownian motion was studied by Bufusi and in the paper of Konstantin Radchenko and Georgi Shevchenko. Our process is called harmonizable representation to distinguish from other types. Okay. Now let us continue. So we have such bound, and of course it is not very convenient to have two terms. How to compare it and so on, it is not so easy. I shall omit maybe integration, only say that integration is possible with respect to our process if H3, which is, what is H3? Minimum of H1 and another coefficient. If this minimal coefficient, if this minimal coefficient is sufficiently big, and exceeds 1/2, Then we can state that our multifractional Brownian motion admits a better upper bound for incremental variance, only one term. It is not very convenient because it is convenient because this term depends only on constant. When we take t minus s sufficiently small, and here is what is zeta of b? Zeta of b maybe was introduced before. Yes, zeta of b is here. It is non-random function of the following form. Okay. So now we have one bound, and if T, S are general from some interval, we should have additional multiplier. Okay. Now we decided to construct a drift parameter estimator for multi-fractional Einstein-Uhlenbeck process. In this connection, it was necessary to consider the rate of growth of multi-fractional Brownian motion. It is a special field in the theory of Gaussian process, how to state something concerning the trajectory behavior of Gaussian processes. This story is implemented in some tedious calculations. And since we have no enough of time, I omit these calculations and only state the main result. So we decide as before that our Hurst function is Hölder and is between two constants. Let it be. And what we can state, let our Hurst function satisfy the previous conditions for some r. Then we have the following rate of growth. This is the power rate of growth with a constants, power constant. Delta is any constant, any positive constant. This h to r appeared before. And Xi does not depend on t and admits the exponential tail. So we have up to this random variable, we have the growth of multi-fractional Brownian motion in time. It is a very useful decompositions, some factorizations of the growth. They can be established in different ways. We went by the way of some additional bounds for Gaussian process and then apply it to multi-fractional Brownian motion. If Hurst function satisfies the initial conditions M1 and M2, then we can state the following. So we assume that we have some upper bound of HT. HT is bounded, so upper bound exists, of course. It can be one, it can be less than one. Then we have the following rate of convergence. T to this bigger power. Maximum with one is taken because we want to consider any T. However, in general, we are interested in the asymptotic behavior. So we have the growth of multi-fractional Brownian motion itself. It is a result that is of independent interest. Now we consider the increments of multi-fractional Brownian motion. I shall omit, of course, skip all technical details. You see a lot of them. It is not so easy way. However, on this way, we get the following result. Z of t, you see here vector t. This vector contains of two coordinates, t2 and t1. And this z is simply the increment, y of t1 minus y of t2. And this is the growth of convergence in T1. This is the term that appears due to the fact that we consider increment. And this is in some sense additional term, logarithm appears every time. Of course, we can replace logarithm in some power. However, let it be for the moment because the power is more important for us. And again, some random variable which does not depend on t and for which we have exponential term. So to consider statistical estimation, let us consider at first the simplest linear model, that we have simply drift coefficient in the linear term and multi-fractional Brownian motion. Since we have the following rate of growth, let us look at it more attentively. This is the rate of growth. And let us assume that this upper limit is less than one. Then of course we can get here some delta, we can take delta sufficiently small and get the index that is less than one, strictly. In this connection, we can consider very simple estimator. We simply divide by T capital. We consider the value of this process at point T capital, divide by this T capital, and due to asymptotic growth of Y, which is of some power that does not exceed T and is strictly less than T, then this additional term, this residual tends to zero. And tends to zero with probability one. The advantage of such growth is that, for example, here or here, its advantage is that we can immediately state what is the asymptotic growth with probability one, because this random variable does not depend on t. And this function determines the upper limit of the growth. So we can divide by t. And we know that this term tends to zero, therefore it is a residual. And we can state the estimator is strongly consistent. For all T capital, we have asymptotic normality. We can calculate a confidence interval. So at least in this simplest situation, we can state everything concerning the most simple statistical estimator of unknown parameter. Of course, much more interesting situation is is with a multifractional Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process. It can be get as the unique solution of multifractional Langevin equation. In general, this equation is very convenient. We can take this linear term, which is the continuous time counterpart of regression term. And here we can have everything. Everything that can be integrated. But indeed, since we have Hölder properties of trajectories of multifractional Brownian motion, and if the trajectories are sufficiently smooth, we can integrate x with respect to x, s with respect to y with respect to y, and so on. So again, the unique solution of this Langevin, multifractional Langevin equation can be represented in the standard form. Using the integration of parts, if you don't like the integral with respect to y, okay, you can avoid this and represent the solution in the following form. For our goals, it is also more interesting because we have y in the pure form, not integral with respect to y. Now, let us consider parameter estimators or unknown parameter theta in our model. To be more precise, we want to estimate the unknown drift parameter by the continuous time observations. So, let us consider the estimator of the following form. If we have our Langevin equation, this is a proposed estimator. Now, our estimator admits the following stochastic representation. And our goal is to state that this additional term, this residual, tends to zero with probability one. What we can state? At first, we can restrict it by some also factorized product. Here we have dependence on T. Of course, if we assume that theta is positive, however, we can apply this estimator only to positive theta, non-ergodic case. Then we have this exponent, big growth of our integral. But then comparing the growth of numerator with denominator, we have developed special technique for this. We can state that in non-ergodic case, the estimator is strongly consistent. Of course, if we have theta equals zero, then this estimator is only consistent, not strongly. We have the convergence in probability. Why only theta positive? Because we use the previously stated upper bounds. But the situation is the following. In the numerator, we shall consider upper bounds. In the denominator, of course, lower bounds. And we can compare them, unfortunately, only in the case when theta is positive. Because in the numerator, I shall explain. In the numerator, we have x and we have y, and we have only one power of exponent, e to power theta t. And here we have second power. So we can compare them and state that the fraction tends to zero only in the case when theta is positive. And the creation of consistent estimator of parameter theta in the ergodic case, which of course is very interesting, is open now. This is an open problem. Now, some references concerning the different definitions of fractional Brownian motion. This one and the paper of Benassi, Serge Cohen, Istas, all of them studied multifractional Gaussian process, but we did not see, I don't know for the moment, but at the moment when we considered the previously mentioned results, we did not know any estimators of drift parameter in such model. And in general, some only what results of identification, but not good results concerning the statistical estimator. So this question is open and is very interesting. The problem is with time, but if the group of people has time to study this, it is a very interesting story. And now I think I shall stop with the lectures in the hall. Thank you very much for all your attention. And I hope that I answered some questions and stated some open problems. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Yuliya, for really inspiring lectures. And I hope it will inspire lots of people to continue in this direction. So right now it's the time for questions. Do you have any questions? Probably everybody is tired by now.
Is a problem exactly. However, both directions need a lot of additional efforts, calculations, and I am sure that they will give a lot of results. For example, till now, it is an open problem, an open applied problem. How to analyze the real data on financial markets and how to try to insert stochastic volatility, how to model this stochastic volatility. So maybe on this stage, even some applications, some applied results will be very interesting because we accumulated some theory and we can accumulate a lot of more theory, but how to apply this theory to the real data? It is a separate but very, very interesting question. And if somebody will interested in this, it will be very nice.
Thank you very much again.
Thank you.
Thank you. And as far as I understand, there will be a book coming based on these lectures. Yes. So we will be looking forward to this book. And by now, I will upload the recordings of those lectures on YouTube next week. So if you miss something, you can always watch it again, which is nice. And also all the slides will be available from the website. So thank you for now. I think we'll stop right now and resume at 1 p.m. Thank you. Yeah.